Only been a while, Ron. I think the last time we talked was when your book was just coming out, but a heck of a lot's happened since then. So it's nice to have you on Do You Know Jack today, of course, speaking at you from the shores of the North Saskatchewan River right here in beautiful Prince Albert, Saskatchewan.
Sounds beautiful to me. I'm there. I am speaking to you from Los Angeles, where I am in rehearsals with Keel for the Frontiers Festival in Milan, and then Keel Fest in Columbus, Ohio on May 10th. So we are grinding hard and heavy here with the Keel rehearsals, and excited to promote the new album from the Ron Keel Band on your show today.
Yeah, for sure, Ron, and I definitely want to get into that, but I mean, first and foremost, I suppose, you know, one of the main reasons why the new record Fight Like a Band is, you know, got some traction is, I think maybe back in January you signed with EMP, is that correct?
It's actually been a couple of years. We signed with EMP in 2017, and we took a long time with this record, 7 months in the studio from April 29th last year until November, 7 months solid, trying to make the best record we possibly could, trying to write, create, and record the best songs we had. And it has been a long, hard ride, and it's great to have the thing out. Now, I love the journey, the creative process with the guys in the band, and working up the new tunes and going into the studio and creating something that, to me, is a very special record. This album is as far as I'm concerned, a peak for me in my career, and the fan response and the media response has echoed those sentiments, because I really do feel it's the best work I've ever done in so many ways, as far as maturity as a songwriter, and just a great solid band of guys playing, singing, writing together as a team. So really proud of the new record and the job that EMP has done. Great to be working with David Ellefson and Tom Hazard of the EMP Label Group.
For sure.
They do everything right, and that's why we signed with them, and it's paying off now.
There's a relationship, though, that you and David have had for quite some time, I would imagine, too, eh?
Yeah, we have known each other for a long time. David Ellefson and I go back to the Steelers Megadeth days and our Hollywood heyday of the 80s, but we didn't really become good friends and know each other that well until 2015, when David brought his band Dollskin to Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
Uh-huh.
My hometown now, and the whole base for the Ron Keel Band. David brought Dollskin to Sioux Falls for his show, and our band was on the bill. And also part of the agenda was to play a set with Dave on bass. And we did some cover songs, did some Megadeth classics, T-Cells, and all that. And throughout the course of those couple of days, Dave and I got to know each other better than we ever have. And I was also getting to know him as a businessman, seeing what he was doing with acts and albums from my peers, like Mark Slaughter and Autograph, which were, these guys are putting out great records on EMP, and they're having a lot of success with them. It was obvious that Dave was very passionate about his business, about the label, and about his artists. And it felt like it was time to do a Ron Keel Band album, and where do we go? And obviously, David Ellefson and EMP was the first choice.
Yeah,
like I said, it's paying off now. You know, one cool story, if I can relate.
When Go for
we signed
it.
The deal, David and I were sitting across the table at in his hometown of Jackson, Minnesota. And David's sitting across the table from me. We got pens in hand and a contract on the table in front of us. And David looked at me and said, "Ron, I want you to sing your life." He didn't want us to rehash the 80s or be something I'm not. He wanted me and my band the way we are, the way we feel, the way we sound. And he gave us that blessing. Whereas a lot of other labels probably would have wanted, quote, another Keel album.
Yeah.
And I think I have more to say and more to play at this point in my career. And David was very supportive of our creative vision and formed a separate imprint on EMP called EMP Outlaw to embrace our style. And it definitely is. EMP Outlaw is the right home for the Ron Keel Band, and it's been a pleasure and a blast working with them, and we're really excited about the response to the new album.
Yeah, for sure.
More than I could have even hoped for, and we're just getting started, man. The record just came out.
Yeah, that's right. March 1st, I think, was the release date. The long-awaited follow-up, of course, to Metal Cowboy. But you know, if you don't mind me saying, Ron, I know there's been hints at that insertion of a little bit of a country or outlaw edge. But I think you really, really got the alchemy right on this one, man. Congratulations. I've been listening to the record the last couple of days and I really enjoyed it.
Thank you. That means a lot to me, and coming from you and some of our other good friends in the media and in radio that are listening to the album and really getting it.
Yeah.
Because it is a diverse record. Choosing the first single was one of the most difficult parts of the process because the record is so diverse. There is some of that classic 80s Keel-esque hard rock that, I know my fans are going to want to hear, and it's going to resonate in the hearts of everybody that supported me through the years since the 80s. There are some other elements, some other personalities, some other colors that we're painting the picture with on this new record. So picking that first single was tough. We had toyed with Girls Like Me, which is, in my opinion, the most fun song on the record. It's super entertaining. It's a really good, fun party song. That's not really what this album is all about. This album is about the struggle to survive and to succeed. And the one song that really encapsulates that emotion and that feeling in a hard rock anthem style is Fight Like a Band, which we have decided as the first single and video. The video just came out and
that's
the response
right.
has been incredible. People are seeing now, not only just hearing, but seeing what the Ron Keel Band is all about. And I really appreciate the response that we've gotten with that first single. Now, Girls Like Me will come out. It'll be a great summer party song here in a couple of months. And there's a lot of serious stuff on this record. Girls Like Me is not serious at all. It's a fun, good time song, and the video as well. I can't wait to unleash that one to follow right up by Like a Band here in 6 or 8 weeks or so.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know what? One thing about this record, though, Ron, is, I mean, you've really got the storytelling aspect in your writing really down. I mean, I'm a little late to the party on the Metal Cowboy release. So, I mean, where does the country music and storytelling influences come from in your own personal sound and style?
Oh, that's huge, because you have to tell stories. It's not enough just to have words that rhyme. You've got to make people feel something. And you have to kind of let down those. There are no rules when it comes to songwriting. It doesn't have to rhyme. It doesn't have to. All it has to do is make people feel something or think something or tell them a story where they can visualize that. And there are a lot of the songs on this record are straight from the heart. Songs like Fight Like a Band. The lyrics obviously are very personal to me, dealing with my wife's bout with cancer, the struggle that I've had in the music business, the struggle that my band has had, continuing to fight to survive and succeed. But there are also some great story songs on this record, like Rock and Roll Guitar, which is not true. It's the story of a guitar that passes from one musician to another. And gosh, you know, if that guitar could talk, whenever you buy an old guitar, you know, 20, 30 year old axe, you just wonder what stories it could tell if it could talk. And that was the inspiration behind Rock and Roll Guitar, is that song, the guitar passes from one musician to the next and then on to the next generation. And even for the end solo on that song, we had a young 16-year-old guitar phenomenon, Eli Dykstra, come in and do the end solo.
Oh, wow.
That blistering, shredding solo at the end of the song is literally the next generation of guitar heroes. So it really brought the story to life. Songs like Hearts Gone Wild, which is a love story between two people who meet in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the night, and fall in love because music is their bond. And I can't give away the end of the story. If you, I know you've heard the record, but if some of your listeners haven't, I think that story really hits home. And so I like the balance between being very personal and very open, opening my scars, my wounds, my heart, my soul, and some of these lyrics, and also the opportunity to tell some stories and to entertain people, because I did learn that from country music, as you were referring to, that there are no throwaway lines or lyrics. Every line has to mean something. It has to say something. It's not just, oh, baby, baby, baby. it's got to mean something. It's got to be real. It's got to have substance. got to be something you can grab and hold on to for the rest of your life. And I do believe I'll be grabbing this record and listening to it and holding on to it for the rest of my life.
Just the mere fact that, you know, one of the stories, you know, one of the songs has such a great story to it that we can't give away the ending, I think is another testament to the great songwriting on this record, Ron, if you don't mind me saying.
I don't mind at all. You can, I appreciate that. It means a lot to me. You know, we're so deep into the creative process and so close to this record. I make albums for myself and for the guys in the band. We made this record for ourselves.
Yeah.
And you can only hope that once you put it out, the people will hear it. It will resonate. They'll understand it. And I'm getting so many responses via the media, people like yourself, on social media, online, that people are listening to the entire album. And that's, to me, that's what an album's all about. It's a listening experience. It's best enjoyed top to bottom on a long road trip or a flight or working around the house. If you're listening on the job, put the record in your playlist or in your player and listen to the entire thing, and you're going to go for a ride with us. It is a very diverse record. There are some re-recorded versions of the Keel classics, which I'm very proud of. And these songs are not getting as much attention as I thought they would.
Yeah.
Because it's a big deal when the Ron Keel Band re-records Tears of Fire, which is a classic Keel song and a big hit for us back in 1986. I felt like that song, first of all, I'm really proud of the new version, but people seem to be gravitating to the new music, listening to the new songs, and those songs are resonating with our audience. But I'm also very proud of the re-recorded Keel versions of Tears of Fire, The Right to Rock, which finally got the vocal treatment I always wanted it to have, and a Keel medley, which includes Because the Night and Somebody's Waiting, which are two classic all-time Keel favorites. So in addition to the 11 brand new original songs, you're going to get that bridge between the classic Keel 80s music and what we're doing now, and it all seems to fit really nicely on one record.
Yeah, and I know there was a bit of a strategy to the re-recorded, Keel classics. I know oftentimes when bands do re-record bits and pieces of their catalog, it's sort of to, get ownership of the songs back, so to speak. I mean, I don't have a huge understanding of the business, but I mean, is that part of what you're doing here as well?
Not at all. No, the reason we did those first. We did the Keel re-recorded versions first. Before we recorded the Fight Like a Band session.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I hadn't written a song in a long time, to be honest with you, Jack. I wasn't sure what was left in the tank. You know, it'd been several years since I'd written.
Yeah.
And I'd never written with the guys in my band, DC Cawthorn, Gino Arce, Scott Schmidt, Jeff Kohler, Jason Haven, the guys that are in the band. I'd never written with them. I didn't know if we could come up with an album's worth of material or not. I wanted to make a record. It was time to make an album. And that kind of your dinner bell in your heart and soul goes off. Is, okay, it's time to make a record.
Right.
And then you figure out how you're going to do it and what you're going to put on it. But somehow I always know it's time. I've got to release it, create and release a new album. So I wasn't sure what we were going to put on it. I just knew we had to make a record.
Yeah.
Obviously, the opportunity to re-record the Keel songs with this lineup was a huge treat for me. Being able to play these songs with these guys and sing them again as they should have been sung had nothing to do with legal rights or licensing or anything like that. It was just, we've been doing the songs in the show anyway. You're always going to hear the Keel classics when you come to a Ron Keel Band show.
Of course.
But I wasn't sure we could come up with an album's worth of material, to be honest with you. And once we opened the floodgate and once those first couple of songs started pouring out, then they just kept coming. And we ended up with 11 great new original songs, which was beyond my wildest expectations. So we included all those. And of course, you got to put the Keel stuff in there too. I want to show the fans that I'm proud of my past. I embrace my history, my legacy, and where I've been, what I've done. But I can't live in the past. I have to live for today and fight for tomorrow. So
yeah, of course.
Those songs, and to hear it, the album in context now, it really does. It sounds like a record. Those Keel songs, Tears of Fire, Right to Rock, they don't stick out like a sore thumb or an apple tree in a cornfield. They belong on the record. They fit right in.
Yeah,
and they
yeah.
are part of what the Ron Keel Band is all about as well.
Sure.
Because I have taken some twists and turns in my career, and I wanted to show the fans and the audience what they're going to get, what they're going to hear, what they're going to experience at a Ron Keel Band show. And it's all of the above, all the stuff on this record and some of those Keel classics as well.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned now that you weren't entirely pleased with your vocals on the original Right to Rock track, which, I mean, many of us that remember hearing it back when it came out in the 80s, you know, I see that track almost as an iconic, you know, 80s release. I mean, you know, what was your original issue with it, Ron?
Oh, now, that is, in my opinion, one of the greatest 80s hard rock / metal anthems of all time. I'm extremely proud of the song. But at the time, man, I was just a kid. I was still learning my craft. I had a lot to learn and a long way to go. And with Gene Simmons producing that record, Gene would keep stuff that he thought really had the attitude. He was looking for attitude. He was looking for a mean, angry young man screaming his guts out,
yeah.
which we got on that Right to Rock album. But vocally, from an actual vocal standpoint, it's not really well executed. There's a lot of pitchy stuff, man. There's some flat notes, some sharp notes. There's a lot of stuff that, you know, I'm lucky to have a second chance in life to be able to. Who wouldn't want to go back and fix some of the screw ups that we had when we were younger?
Sure.
And I got that opportunity with this album and on these songs, just to sing properly and to sing better. I do feel at this stage of the game, I'm a way better singer than I was in 1985, 86. I'm really proud to say that. It comes with a lot of hard work, a lot of practice, a lot of heart, a lot of passion. The voice comes from deep within me, and I have a burning desire to sing well and to be as good as I possibly can. You know, a lot of these 80s bands are judged upon, does the front man still have it? Can the singer still hit the notes? Can the singer still deliver? And it is difficult as we get older to maintain that voice. I believe that the secret to my longevity is in hard work and practice. I sing 3 hours a day. I talk on the radio. I talk on the interviews, doing shows like yours, like we're doing now. I use my voice often, and I obviously, you can tell, I speak pretty loud. I only have one gear, and it's loud.
Yeah.
And I do believe that's the key to my longevity, the fact that I do work at it, I practice. Today we've got a 6-7 hour rehearsal. As soon as I'm done with this interview, I'm going to the studio with my guys. I'm going to belt it out. I'm going to scream my guts out all day long. And I'm going to do it again tomorrow. So I do credit that work ethic and that passion with being able to keep my voice on a sustained level of at least where I can listen to it, and I'm proud of it.
I'm proud
of the shows. I'm proud of the work I did on this new record. And I think it shows with the people that are listening to it. Sounds like Ron Keel, only now it sounds like he's grown up. And he's not, maybe mature isn't the right word for it, but he's a man now. And I'm proud of what I've done, and I'm glad the fans are enjoying it.
For sure, for sure. Well, just really quick now, I mean, you did mention the members of your band, you know, basically the foundation of the Badlands House Band. You know, you guys have been together for 3 or 4 years and played with a wide range of artists. So, I mean, have you been inspired by some of these other artists that you've been, you know, able to share the stage with as the Badlands House Band? I think, you know, Paul Stanley is the big one that comes to mind. But, I mean, also Kip Winger, Mark Slaughter, you know, Stephen Piercy. I mean, you know, was that part of your inspiration, too, to get back on the horse, so to speak, and record another record?
No, I've never left the horse. I've always been active. I've always been, you know, like I said, I didn't write for a few years, but that's,
yeah.
I go through phases like that. But I've always sung, performed, rocked out with my guys. Those experiences with the names you mentioned, Paul Stanley, Kip Winger, Jack Blades, that was our job at the time. We were hired for a job. We were paid well. And we were given all of the perks of rock stardom with a tour bus and a great crew and gear and promotion and advertising and all of the stuff that you need and that you dream of. And those opportunities were fantastic for us, but certainly proved to me that my band is as good as or better than any of those bands out there, because we could back up Paul Stanley and Jack Blades and Kip Winger, who's a hard ass. I love Kip. He's a good friend of mine, man, but he does not accept any. There's no slack when you're backing up Kip Winger on his Winger's greatest hits.
Yeah.
And it proved to me that the band was competitive on a world-class level. And also, those experiences cemented our bond as friends and as brothers. When you're in the rehearsal room for literally for weeks on end, trying to make sure that when that artist gets, when Paul Stanley gets off the plane and walks on the stage, you want to make sure you kick his ass. And we did, and we have. So those experiences are a big part of the building process when we were the Badlands House Band. As many of our listeners and fans, and you probably know, after about a year, that whole business imploded, and we were left with nothing. We got everything yanked away from us, all of our support, our backing. We lost our jobs. We lost our bus. We lost everything, and all we had left was each other. At the same time, literally 3 weeks later, my wife was diagnosed with cancer, and we had, you know, she had 7 surgeries, chemo, radiation, a very scary time for us, a very long year. And I had to go to the guys in my band. First of all, okay, we're, you know, the plug has been pulled, so to speak. What are we going to do now?
Yeah.
And everybody just felt like the right thing to do was to stay together, keep playing music. And then I had to go to them and tell them, look, man, I don't know how much I can tour next year, if I can even, you know, do a lot of shows, because I've got to be here for my wife when she's going through surgery and chemo and radiation. And so if we can't tour, we can at least write some songs.
Yeah.
That was the creative impetus. What am I going to do with this band now? How can I set a benchmark, so to speak, and create a goal that we can all work together towards? And that goal was this Fight Like a Band album, and I think we achieved that
for sure,
in a way that beyond my wildest dreams and expectations. And throughout that entire process, the band was my support group. They've been there for me, and it really has that tightness, that the fact that we really like each other, we really like playing together, it really shows on this record, man. That bond is in every chord and every note of this new Fight Like a Band album.
Yeah.
I do believe that we all really respect and appreciate this opportunity at this stage of the game, because we're not getting any younger. Nobody is. Father Time's going to kick all of our asses in the long run, and we know that we'll never have another group of guys or an opportunity like this. So we cherish every day, every song, every show, every moment, because we know that at this age, at this stage of the game, I'm going to play another 10 years. I announced my retirement on my birthday, and I'm going to go till I'm, I think, what is it, 68, I think, on the date that I've got set for my retirement. But
yeah.
While we can, let's do this and do it with as much energy and as much passion and as much fire as we could possibly build. So I think that's a very special element that we have that younger bands may not have.
Yeah, for sure.
When you're young, you think it's gonna last forever. The ride goes on, and you know, at this point, for me, there's more behind me than there is in front of me. So I think that appreciation for each other and for this opportunity really fuels what the Ron Keel Band is all about.
Yeah, for sure. Well, listen, man. On that note, you know, fight like a band released March 1st, and of course, the single of the same name literally just came out in the last couple of days. Just one more time, Ron, you got a couple of dates coming up in the future that you mentioned off the top. If you want to plug those again, that would be awesome, sir.
Absolutely. Well, I'd love to plug the website, first of all, because that's where you can find me online, ronkeel.com and ronkeelband.com. If you want the tour dates and social media links and all the other stuff, that's where you go. And we're really excited about some of these big shows we've got on the horizon, of course, Keel Fest, May 10th in Columbus, Ohio. A dream come true for me to have all my friends, brothers, and bandmates under one roof on one stage in one night performing the Ron Keel Band album, performing the Keel classics, the Steeler music we haven't played in, 35 years or more, and just a big celebration of my friendship our fans, our music, and the guys that I've done this with now for decades. And a lot of big bike events coming up this summer. Big one in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, our hometown, Hot Harley Nights with Night Ranger. And so we'll be looking forward to seeing our buddy Jack Blades again at that event.
Right on.
A lot of bike events. We're tailor-made for that kind of thing. This is outlaw, hard and heavy rock and roll. So the biker community really embraces us, and we embrace them in return. And also Keel back on the Monsters of Rock cruise in 2020. I think they're going to announce that tomorrow, but by the time the word gets out, I'd like to say it on your show first.
Right,
I have
on.
Not made any social media announcements or posted anything, but I tell you right now, Keel back on the Monsters of Rock cruise in 2020. And lots more where that came from. So keep up with us online at ronkeel.com.
Right on, Ron. Well, it's always a pleasure and an honor. Like I said, we haven't talked in a while, but I'm sure glad we were able to chat today, man. Awesome. Thanks for your time.
Me too, Jack. Thanks so much for the opportunity and for your support. I appreciate what you do, and just crank it up and keep it up, my friend.
Right on. Have a good day, sir.
You too.
Okay, bye-bye.